What happens if the moon, if water moves? So for example, say, for the moon or a case, say we have a dam on natural ground, then you have a water level at the upstream, and you have a lower level. This is the steady state condition. So this water level doesn't change with time. So it is always at the fixed level constant. That because this is a funnel and dam is impermeable, the water doesn't go through the dam. Instead, it will flow through the ground underneath the dam. Then, in terms of the water resource technology or water resource engineering, they want to find water flow rate. And how much water flows in unit time, in second or in minute, or in hour. And they want to find that 10 tons of tons per minute, tons per minute, or 10 tons per second. Those kind of numbers will be needed for testing the water resource. And in terms of the dam safety, because we are a geotechnical engineer, we want to find this dam is, you know, ensure is the safety of this dam, whether this dam is safe enough during this water flow. Then, what will be the effective stress? Water doesn't move, what will it be? The total stress. Total stress will be the depth, like V1 and V2. And if you know the density of each soil and the water, then you can calculate the total density, right? And pore pressure also. Pore pressure will be what? Water density, G, and V1 plus V2. Is it going to be the same? Will you have the same pore pressure when water moves? And here, compared to the steady case, you can calculate the water pressure with this, right? When water moves upward, this case, water moves from down to up side, right? Actual water pressure will be larger or less. Okay. What about this? This will be the opposite case then. Water is going down. So the pore pressure going up or less than that. So this will be the problem that we're going to solve for the next three lectures. So, if the water doesn't move, the simple, right? The problem is very simple. We can just calculate from the density profile. But if water starts moving, then we'll have to look at the hydraulic gradient, how fast water is moving. So, that's what we're going to talk about. And another case would be excavation site. Excavation site is the case when you have a underwater soil. Let's say that you have a water level above the ground surface. Now you want to dig a hole. Then you will place a temporary wall like this. You can think of the circular wall that's isolating the inside system. Then you can pump up, so you can place the underwater pump so that you can pump up water. So that you can make it drive and you can go and dig the hole. But at the same time, the water will go, water flows always at the higher ground to the lower ground. Right? And here, if the water level gets lower, and now the water level is here, so the water flow like this. Then all the cube, storage. And deciding this storage is important because depending on the size of the storage, the amount of the water flows in, you're going to have to decide the specification of the pump. You may need a very large pump, you may need a small pump, maybe you may need several small pumps, something like that. So you can decide which kind of pump that you need to use to make it dry at the surface. So this is the one decision that you have to make. You also make. Now we're going to go over a few governing relations related to the water flow in soil. So this is a very fundamental physics that we assume in the soil mechanics. First is incompressible water. So incompressible water means that there is no density. Actually, the liquid, no way the fluid density is depending on the temperature and pressure. So as temperature increases, the fluid density generally decreases. And as the pressure increases, because it compresses more, so the density also increases. But water has very special character. There, the compressibility is much, much lower than the other liquids. So it doesn't compress that much. It only escapes material. So that the water, you assume that the stress level is not that very wide, so that we can assume the water density is also continuously like 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter or the 1 gram per cubic centimeter. Flow is that you have a tube with water in it, and when you have a water level H to the center of the outlet is the kinetic energy, right? The potential energy the water has. As the H increases, all the velocity. So as the height goes up, outlet velocity will be decreasing or increasing? Increasing, because the larger difference in the height, you get more faster water flow. So the velocity will increase like this. And at some point, the water will make the turbulent flow. The H is too big. So, in general, you guys want to have taken the fluid mechanics, velocity, and hydraulic gradient. So this, you can think of the H, a hydraulic gradient is the how much height difference you have across the samples. So as the h increases, the velocity will increase. And when you, as you decrease, you get a little bit different phenomena, there's a hysteresis. And this linear portion is called a lambda. The first early stage where the molar velocity is proportional to the size of the gradient is called the laminar state. And here it's called the turbulent state. And between is the transient. So in turbulent state, not only water goes straight, also there's a backward flow. Water goes straight, and also there's a backward flow. But in the laminar stage, all the water moves straight. The direction of the water. Here in the laminar state, we can assume that the velocity of water is proportional to the height of the gradient because they have a linear relationship. And from this, Darcy's flow is came. Comes out in Darcy's flow. Darcy's flow. Mechanics, we assume that the all water flows in soil is in the laminar state. So that you can assume this Darcy's flow is valid and it's in the laminar flow. So that the flow velocity is proportional to the height of the gradient. And then we have height that has different diameters from inlet and outlet. So you have a water going in here, that's Q1. Here you have a Q out. Q in and Q out. Velocity is the in, area is the A, so in. At the outlet, also you can define the outlet velocity and what's out and the area. And the flow rate is defined as water velocity times area. And this Q is for the flow rate or discharge rate. And what's the dimension of the velocity? The length per time. Right? And area is the length square. So the dimension for this rate of discharge or flow rate is volume per time.
So it's in general volume per
time.
Cubic meter per second or cubic meter per minute or
a millimeter per minute. And the law of mass conservation is that simply the amount of water going in is the same as the amount of water going out, coming out. The Q in equals the Q out. This is the mass conservation law. And from this, we can expand it. The velocity and the area. Then force. Now we talked about the mass conservation, so now it's going to be about the energy conservation. Energy conservation is also called as a Bernoulli's equation. Bernoulli's equation is considering three kinds of energy type. First will be potential energy. Summation of all these. This is always constant.
still low awareness conservation. In hydraulics and in the soil mechanics, instead of using the kinetic and potential and pressure energy in the energy demanding, we simplify and instead we use the head. And this head can be calculated by dividing the energy with the unit weight, so the mass times dedication. So if you do it this, if you do this, then the that equation will be simplified as one of H times H plus V square over 2G plus P and G. And this will be the function. And this is the head, so we can say that this is the elevation head. And this is velocity head. And this is pressure head. Instead of the potential and kinetic and pressure head, pressure energy, we use the elevation head and the velocity head and the then this will be expressed as next meter. So it's gonna be like 10 meter or 5 meter or 2 meter. As water flows through the pipe, because of the friction between the fluid and the solid, so you will have energy loss. And that's called the head friction loss. And we denote that the friction loss as H sub L. And we test it, if you consider this friction loss, at the inlet is PA and velocity A. And here HB and pressure B. Then HA plus PA is the left part, the water as water flows like this. And PA over PA square over so in the inner part, you have an elevation head and velocity head, pressure head. And if there is no friction loss, you don't have this term. So the energy should be conserved so that you have an inner energy same with the outer energy. But if because of the piston loss, you had this term HL, which is head loss in the device side. Most of the flow problems, water flow problems in soil, the velocity of the water is small enough to be neglected. So we can compare it to the elevation head and the pressure head. This velocity head is very small, so we can ignore this part, this term. So if the total head will be the summation of elevation head and the pressure head. So we just need to memorize this equation. The total head is the sum of pressure and elevation head.